Hi writers and welcome back to the Write channel. So today's course video is all about character. I'm going to talk you through how writers create great characters with an example, and then I'm going to give you a step-by-step method to try yourself. I'm also going to talk to you about the relationship between plot and character and how important that is, and I'm going to give you an exercise to try out some of these ideas for yourself. I will be calling on my trusty YouTube assistance dogs, so stay tuned for a Bongo and Elvis moment. All right, let's get going. I want you to think about when you're reading, because there are particular ways that readers relate to characters, and it's not that different to the way we relate to people in the world around us. So let's say a friend tells us that somebody is not to be trusted, or they tell us that somebody is a very cheerful person and fun to be around. We're probably going to believe them to a certain extent, but we're definitely going to believe this more if we see it happen. So if we see someone being deceitful, or we see somebody being the life and soul of the party, then it becomes much more real to us. And that's exactly how it works when we're reading a book. If we are told by the author that this character is a certain way, let's say we're told that they're brave, or we're told that they're loyal, then we'll probably believe the author, depending on how much we trust them as an individual. But if we see the character behaving that way on the page, then we're going to believe that in a much more convinced kind of way. So one of the things we need to do as writers is make the character behave the way we want the reader to see them on the page, and not just tell the reader what the character's like. That's just another aspect of the rule that you'll have heard 100 times before of show, don't tell. So let's talk about an example. So one of the characters that I remember very vividly in fairly recent fiction is Hermione Granger, because she is really quite a special and unique character. She's one of those characters where you do feel that you know them as a person. You actually forget, or can easily forget, that this is a made-up person, and you start to think of them as an actual human being. And that's part of the trick. So how does J.K. Rowling do that? Does she just tell us that Hermione is brave? Does she tell us that she's loyal to her friends? Does she tell us that she's bookish and really clever? There may well be moments in the narrative where she does say those things, but actually, the reason we believe it and that we know these things about Hermione and that we feel her presence really vividly is because we see those things on the page. We see her hand shoot up every time the teacher asks a question in class. We see her carrying books off to an adventure when she's trying to save the world. We see her stepping in to save her friends, and we see her cutting off her family to save them. So Hermione does brave things, loyal things, and clever things on the page, in the action, and we believe in her. We forget that she's a made-up person, which is quite a trick. So how can we mere mortals try and repeat this and try and convince our readers that these characters are not made up and that they're real people? Well, I've got some tips for you. Like everything in creative writing, it's very personal and there is no one size fits all. So it's a matter of finding what works for you. But I'm going to give you the steps that I go through. And as usual, my advice is to try everything, find out if it helps you, and then just refine the process in a way that works for you. So here goes. Here's my steps for creating great characters. So step one, and the thing that I do first of all in my writing process, is to find out about the characters by writing about them. Now this might sound quite strange, but often you'll get a bit of a sense of somebody, the person that you want to write about, straight away. And for me, the first step is to then take that and put them in scenes. Now some of that might be stuff that ends up in the book, and some of it might be more exploratory writing. I might do writing prompts. So when I'm developing an idea and thinking about a character, I might just go to the internet, find a writing prompt, but make sure that I include my character in that prompt so that I'm exploring them and writing things about them. And I might write chapters of the book or scenes of the book or parts of the book that I actually know. You know, there might be a few things. It might even be the ending. Sometimes I do write the ending first, not very often, but sometimes. But I will play with the character, put them in different situations and work out who they are. Not completely, but it starts to give me a sense of who they are and what they're like. And I find that's a better method for me when I'm beginning to get to know my character. So that's the first thing to do. Try and do some writing and see what happens. Start to get to know who your characters are. But there are lots of other things you can do once you have got to know your character a little bit and you've got some sense of who they are. And there are things that you can do to then develop them further. So you can find character profiles. They're all over the internet. You just need to do a Google search and you'll find loads of character profiles. But there are some links below to some of the ones that I've found useful. You can also do character CVs. Imagine that your character is applying for a job. What would their CV say? You can also do things like character questionnaires. And actually, you could do something where you get a friend to ask you lots of questions, you pretend to be the character, and you answer those questions. The idea of this kind of thing is like a brainstorming, really, more of a stimulation to get your imagination going. Sometimes you've got a sense of a character, and then asking questions like this and answering questions like this can just help that grow. Sometimes you don't have much sense of a character, and asking lots of questions or writing a CV can help you start making that stuff up. Because at the end of the day, that's all we're doing, isn't it? Making this stuff up. But sometimes these structures can help you to start doing that. You can get character profiles from all over the place, but one of the things that I use that has character profiles inbuilt in it is Scrivener, which is a really nice piece of software for writers. If you haven't tried it, give it a go. You can get a free trial for a month. Again, I'll put links below, but it has a really nice character profile in it. In that profile, it has all the kind of things that you need, you know, things like motivations and goals. It has things like physical appearance, and you can change it. You can alter that profile so that you can add all the things that you think are important about building a character. So I tend to do that in Scrivener for most of my characters, and I'll often go to the internet and search for the kind of person I want. So maybe they've got red hair, maybe they've got black hair, maybe they've got blue eyes, whatever it is I want, I'll search for that in Google, and I'll look for an image that feels appropriate for my character and then put that in the character profile. What your character looks like isn't the most important thing, but it is one of the things you need to know. It's a bit like that Hemingway's iceberg where you know this much and you put this much on the page, but if you know everything about your character and you can picture them, then that's really important to bringing them to life. The thing about this step is if you're not careful, it can be a bit boring. I mean, I honestly don't find it that exciting to fill in character profiles. Maybe some people do, I don't know, I'm not judging you. But I don't find those lists of things very exciting. So I think here it's important to be a bit creative, which is why I suggest things like CVs. You could also write a letter or an email to someone significant in their life. And anything at all, really. I mean, I quite like mood boards and Pinterest boards, which I sometimes put together for my characters to get a sense of who they are. But do feel free here to be creative, to do things with music and visual stuff, because actually, this wants to be an exciting part of your process as well. Otherwise, you're not going to engage with it in the same way as you do the rest of your process. Now, for me, I have a step three. I write something that I call a character doodle. Now, that's just a very personal word for what it is. It's something that is one of the steps to build your characters in the snowflake method. Now, my doodles contain very specific things. Of course, you've got the name, one sentence summary of their story, their motivation and their goal, which aren't exactly the same thing. The motivation is the thing that drives them, and the goal is the thing that they want. And sometimes they know those things and sometimes they don't know them. So it can be quite complex. Feel free to interpret some of these things any way that helps you write the character. It's not that important to know exactly what everything means in terms of how I see it, but it's what helps you build the character. Right at the end of the doodle, I will write a paragraph summary of that character's story within the narrative. So it's like I'm writing a little mini outline for each character. Again, I'll link to a copy of my doodles in the description here so you can download it for yourself and see if it helps you. And like I said right at the beginning, it's about trying these different things and finding stuff that works for you. So feel free to throw that one in the bin if it doesn't help you. But I find these mini character outlines really helpful. So give it a go. So when I get to step four of my character process, what I do is I write some more. Now at this stage, it is usually writing that's going to go in the book. So it is usually scenes that I want to be part of my story. I might still do a little bit of exploratory writing, but things are very firmed up at this point. So I've got a sense of who the character is and what the story is and what's going to happen. So I'll start to put the character in those scenes and try it out. And again, the character might surprise me. I might find that things happen that I'm not expecting. I might find that some of the plot that I've got planned isn't appropriate for that character at all. So it's important to make sure that you're flexible at this stage, because everything can change. And if you're not flexible and you don't let things change when they should, it's all going to feel wrong. Please make sure that you see any planning, any outline, anything like that that you do as a blueprint for what's going to happen and not a straitjacket. You don't have to do it that way because you wrote it on a card in Scrivener or because you wrote it on an index card and put it on your desk. You can change everything. And if your characters are encouraging you to change it, I'd listen to them, because I think that's really important. Step number five is where you repeat any of the previous five steps that you want to, as many times as you want to. This is all about going in and out of the planning and in and out of the narrative. So you should feel free to go back. So if you're writing and you come to a point where your character's in a certain situation and you're not sure what they do, well, in that case, maybe you don't know the character enough. So maybe you need to go back to some of the profiling and some of the development work again. And then maybe when you've done some of that again, you'll be ready to get on with the writing. I find I to and fro quite a lot at this point. If I get to the point with the writing where I feel a little bit stuck, I can go back to my planning documents and at least I'm doing something and moving my project forward, even if I'm not actually adding words to it. So my step six, which I haven't quite got enough fingers for, is all about once you've got a full first draft. So it's about editing and drafting and making it better. So here's where you're going to really focus on that show don't tell thing. And it is okay to tell some of the time. It isn't about showing everything and never telling. It's about getting the balance right. But the thing about creating believable characters is that you will have to show some of the character traits for people to believe in them properly. So as you go through your manuscript and your editing, look at where you're telling the reader things. Is that right? Is the balance right? And where you're telling the reader something that is specifically about a character and what they're like, can you show it instead? And also you might find it's something that I call show and tell when I'm doing feedback. You might find that you have shown something about a character, but then you've lost a little bit of confidence in that. So you tell the reader as well. So watch for that too. Watch for show and tell. But this is a really important stage, and I think editing is everything. What did they say? All writing is rewriting, and I think that's really true. Do at least one edit where your main focus is character, and just make sure that you are showing character as much as possible and not just telling the reader what to think about your characters. Okay, so now I've got a fun exercise to get you thinking about character. Over to my beautiful YouTube assistance dogs, Bongo and Elvis.
Okay, so the exercise is about my dogs, Bongo and Elvis. You've met Bongo and Elvis before, but just to remind you what they're like, this is Bongo. She's very beautiful. She likes to wag her tail. She's quite enthusiastic and she loves a walk, but she is quite nervous and she's slightly scared of cars. Always has been, as this little bit of video will confirm. Now, this one is Elvis. Elvis is much more laid back. A much more calm, relaxed, chill kind of dog. I mean, half the time, he might as well be asleep, he's so relaxed. I want you to create two different characters using my dogs as starting points. Now, I don't mean doggy characters for a children's story or anything like that. Although, if that's what you write and that's the kind of thing you want to do, by all means, go for it. But equally, you could do characters in a novel, just using those traits that the two dogs have. So create those characters and then put them in a scene together. My only specification for the scene is that they should bump into each other unexpectedly somewhere and have not seen each other for years before that. So please have a go at the exercise and put your results in the comments below. I look forward to reading some of them.
Okay, so that's character done, and now you're going to go away and create only great characters. I'm looking forward to seeing my dogs playing a starring role in your next novels, maybe in heavily disguised reincarnations. Elvis actually plays a starring role in one of my novels. If you want to know a bit more about that, follow the card up there to my website and you can find out all about Dead Flowers, where Elvis is a star. So if you liked this video, please do give it a thumbs up below and tell me in the comments what helped or what you'd like to see more of. My next course video will be all about story structure, so do make sure that you subscribe and press the bell for updates so you don't miss out. And I'll see you in the next one. Take care.